kind of to wrap things up, on cup bearing, the chalice is the blood of Christ through the wine. It's vastly important. It's part of communion, it's part of us being renewed after the image of Christ. It can be a nerve-wracking thing to think about giving such a wonderful gift to people. And yet, it's a wonderful gift. It's a blessing to get to serve in that way, to share the blood of Christ with a fellow believer. And so, it's simply wine that has become for us the blood of Christ through the Word of God, and the Holy Spirit acting through that Word. So as I have uncovered it and prepared the table during the offering, we have the name which always slips my mind. What you call the
pack?
The little bottles that have the wine and
cruet.
The cruet. Thank you. For the life of me, I can't remember the word cruet. We have the cruet from which I fill up the chalice. Finish the Eucharistic prayer. I serve myself. When receiving the bread, it's perfectly simple to say the bread of Christ. The bread of life. The body of Christ, the bread of life. That's what I say with the bread. With the wine, the blood of Christ, the cup of salvation. That's the simple way that we do it. That's the simple phrase. There's a longer phrase that the prayer book also uses that has slipped my mind at the moment. That for those who may have been Episcopalians before, with the previous 1928 prayer book, they probably know that older way of saying it by heart. The blood of Christ.
This is the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, keep you in everlasting life.
Yeah, exactly.
That's the one I know. Cup of salvation.
Yeah.
That's the cup of salvation, yeah.
The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was shed for you, preserve you body and soul into everlasting life.
That's right. Yeah.
I really like that because the emphasis is that this blood of Christ is for both body and soul. It's not merely spiritual, but it's for both physical life and spiritual life. It brings us ever closer to our resurrection from the dead, to that day of resurrection when Jesus returns, because it is Jesus' resurrected body that we are partaking of. So there's this mysterious sense, and even though our physical bodies are still failing, growing old, and wearing out, they're still simultaneously being renewed spiritually, not just spiritually, but physically by partaking of that resurrected body and blood of Christ through the bread and wine. And it's just an exciting thing to think about that. So after I receive, if you're the chalice bearer, Warwick, would you help us demonstrate? How would you come up, Warwick? Like you were first approaching the altar, you would stop, bow toward the cross, and then come over here to the side. I'd offer him the bread, then step over, offer him the cup. And if he was a regular receiver, so say I was the chalice bearer and he was just coming up to receive, I handed him the cup. Some people are very comfortable with that in drinking from the cup, is to hand it into their hands and then take it to their own lips. Others will want you to continue holding it. You kind of have to learn each person. Each person's a little different, where I would take it and they might guide it, but I would continue holding it to help lead it to their lips, and they guide it toward their mouth, but they don't want to hold the full weight of the cup. So everyone's different, and you just kind of learn to play it by ear and to kind of briefly hold it, and if they feel like they're fully lifting it under all their power, you can let them do that. But if they don't feel like if they're waiting for you to start moving the cup, then you start moving. If they take it and they're holding it, but they're not moving, then you start lifting it toward their lips if they're receiving from the common cup. Again, it's something to get used to. You can just assume everyone wants you to lift it toward their lips when you first start, if you've never done it before. John?
Just to throw this in there, I'm kind of tall. Some of us here are tall, and some that have held on to it will hold it there with a death grip. And you know, I usually hold Jubilee while I'm taking communion, and I'm bending down because it's not coming any higher than this, right?
Yeah.
So yeah, be aware of
yeah,
how people are doing it.
Yeah. maybe as cupbearers, that we pause for a moment and ask them, do you want to hold the cup yourself to partake?
Yeah.
Or how do you want me to help? And maybe sometimes we may need to do that, to help the other person out. Back when I was Lutheran, and back in the day when there would be an altar rail, that makes it so much easier for the cupbearer, because everyone's always shorter than the cupbearer.
Oh, yeah.
It's one moment where I do miss having an altar rail when I've been the cupbearer, is I can lean it over to them instead of when someone like Jonathan or my cousin Tim, my wife's cousin Tim, who's 6'10". And that's a moment where I would be like, you're taking the cup, my friend. I can't lift it that high. I'm not sure if I should. So just be aware. You kind of have to learn to anticipate. And thankfully, we're a forgiving congregation. If you're new to cup bearing and you make a mistake and you hang on to the cup when you shouldn't have, you'll know no one's going to get mad. I just hope that you don't let go of the cup when you should have held on to it.
Don't drop the bag.
It's not the end of the world if that happens. We can bless more wine.
I was always told you don't leave go. You can guide it and just keep your hand on it.
Yeah, in the past that's been the general practice. I've discovered, though, that there are people who would, especially when you're encountering someone who is taller than you, to make it easier for them to let them feel the weight of the cup and not just guide it, but to fully take it to themselves. I've always said that, but it is true that the former practice has been for the chalice bearer to always keep a death grip on the cup and to make sure you've got it fully under your control and aren't going to let it fall. So the other way that people receive the wine is what we call intinction. All that is just simply they take the wafer, and I should have kept a wafer out just to have one, but they take the wafer and they dip it in the wine. And you just simply hold it there, they dip it in the wine, and you say the words of, that go with it. The blood of Christ, the cup of salvation, as they receive the wine and wafer at the same time together.
That's another one. You have to measure the height of the person. So they're not trying to reach them.
When my boys come up, you got to bend down. And then at the end, if you're the cupbearer, after we finished giving communion to everyone, I always walk her back around to the altar. You can follow along as Warwick did today. He came up to the side of the altar to hand me the cup. Others will wait on this side of the altar to hand me the cup after I've reached the center again. Either way works. Either way is perfectly fine. You can also, as cupbearer, receive a little bit extra of the body and blood of Christ. In that sense, you can help me finish the elements if there are any left over.
So how do I decide that? There's a lot left today, and I was lost up. Maybe I should help.
Well, I mean, it's up to you.
Yeah.
Up to you. There have been times where, when I was at my previous church, where we had a lot of people who wouldn't drink from the cup, who always would intinct. And it happened to be that my chalice bearer that day, as I was serving the bread, was a chalice bearer who never drank from the cup afterwards. And it happened to be that everyone who came through our line, virtually everyone, did intinction. So I had, and I was the one who had set up communion that day, and I'd put way too much wine in that cup. And so I ended up helping to finish up the elements, and that was the cup I ended up with. And I got a very, very substantial amount of consecrated wine to finish.
Will you tell us when you think you need us to do that?
I try not to. Being a smaller congregation, I don't put as much wine in it as I would when I was at King of Kings with a much larger congregation. And it's just, if you want to, you can. It does not matter to me if you do or if you do not. So if you're comfortable helping to finish the consecrated elements afterwards, you may. If I have a few of the wafers left over, if I have too many, I will definitely stop and share them. If I only have two or three, I usually just consume those on my own because that's not too many. But there have been a few times where I had five or six or seven left over, and very hard to consume all of those reverently. at once.
Or by the side, whatever you can do.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Or if or you're front, even at the there. Front, I can hand the elements, okay. The consecrated bread. So that's part of chalice bearing, is helping to finish the elements if there are a lot left over. I'm getting better at counting the congregation and not getting too many wafers, and that's a good thing, to minimize how much we have left over at the end.